still, there is a river that flows from Calvary's tree, a fountain for the thirsty, your grace that washes over me. Let faith arise. Dream after dream, you are speaking to me, breathing word after word of kingdom come. Here at your feet, I can see the unseen. Truly, one look at you and I'm undone.
Good morning, welcome to God's house. It's a good day to worship Him. Because of your love, we're forgiven.
Thank you.
thank him this morning. Praise you, Father. He's the everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you will reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. In need, you lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope.
Let's thank him this morning. Hallelujah.
Lord, every day we want to just draw closer to you, to move into your presence, to know you more, to give you more of ourselves, Lord, that you might fill us with your glory, with your power. Just draw us close.
Draw me close to you. Cause nothing else could take your place, to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way, bring me back to you. 'cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way, bring me back to you.
This morning, thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. And you're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. In this place this morning. It's so good that we can carry our needs to Him, no matter what they are, no matter how big or small. Just bring all your needs to the together. Just bring all your needs to the His blood.
touches the fall of the sparrow, concerned with the lilies so fair, how much more he cares for the sheep of his pastures. So bring him your burdens to bear. Bring all your needs to the altar. Bring all your needs to the Lord.
So great to be in the Lord's house on Thanksgiving weekend. We have so much to be thankful for, so much to be grateful for. God has done so much for us and in us and with us. I heard a story of a friend whose little granddaughter, 7 years old, second grader, was at school, and the teacher was going around the room saying, "Why don't you tell us what you're thankful for?" And she very expressively said, "I'm so thankful that I'm drug-free." Well, when Mama heard about that, she made sure the teacher knew the whole family was drug-free. I think sometimes it's the little things that really speak to our spirit and to our heart. It's good to be thankful in everything. Bible says for us to be thankful in all things, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Sometimes you have to work at being thankful, don't you? This morning, we can be thankful that we're in the presence of the Lord. For he said, if two or three gather together, I am here. We can be thankful that we can call unto him. For he said, if you'll do so, I'll hear and I'll answer and I'll show you great and mighty things. We can be thankful that the blood of Jesus Christ not only saved our souls, but provides healing for us, protection for us, and strength for us. I am so glad that I was full of turkey a couple days ago. But I'm more glad that I am full and covered with the blood of Jesus Christ. I may not have a bite to eat on the table, but if I have Jesus, I have everything. And this morning, if you walked in here carrying your burdens, the song we just sang was meant for you. Bring your cares, your needs to the altar. The altar doesn't necessarily mean the place at the front of the building. The altar is wherever you and God meet. And whatever you walked in here with today, you can leave it here. This morning as we pray, I want to stir your faith. Somebody's going to be healed. Somebody's going to be touched by the Lord. Some burden is going to be lifted. Because the Bible said if we ask, we could have it. He said if two or three agree on any one thing is touching heaven, it's yours. This morning, if you need healing in your body, lift both hands to heaven right now and begin to thank Jesus for healing. Lord, I thank you for healing right now in Jesus' name. I thank you for it in the name that's above every name. I thank you for miraculous working power right now. We command our body to yield to the word of the Lord. I said, by his stripes we are healed. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, if there are those with heavy burdens today, we lay them at the altar. You said, casting all our cares upon Him, for He cares for us. Come on, lift your hands this morning and thank the Lord that He's heard us and He's answered His prayers. Thank you, Lord, for meeting financial needs. Thank you, Lord, for meeting relational needs. Thank you, Lord, for making a way where there doesn't seem to be a way. Thank you, Lord, for opening doors that no man can shut. Thank you, Lord, for provision and blessing. We give glory and honor to your name. We bless you. We bless you. I think you can do better than that. Just lift your voice and give a shout of praise to the Lord this morning. We bless you, Lord. We exalt your name, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now we are people of faith, but we're also people of good sense. That's something that's not in Washington, D.C. Take a few moments, shake hands. If you don't feel like shaking someone's hand, don't get offended. That's okay. We're being careful right now. There are some folks that haven't been out in a long time, and we want to honor that. So take a few moments, greet one another. Be sure to put your tithe and offerings in the buckets at the back, and the Lord bless you this morning.
James Arness as Matt Dillon.
Morning, Miss Kitty.
Those are the prettiest shoes I ever seen.
Yep, there's some good lookers there, all right.
They're just too high for me. I can't afford something like that.
Miss Kitty, I'd buy any one of those if you'd go to the women's meeting next Saturday at 10 a.m.
You would for me?
Yeah, right there. Those ones right there.
Oh, please, Matt. That'd be awesome. I'll do it.
Well, I'll pick you up 10 a.m., Kitty, and we'll go together, all right? That sound all right to you? You and me.
Mr. Jones, if you tell any of the girls that I'm going to a religious meeting, you and I are going to have some words. Come on here.
Doc, there's something that's just fuddling with my head, and I don't even know about it.
What?
So we got that there, Dr. Clancy. You're going to come give doctrine, right?
Yeah.
So this here Dr. Clancy is coming Wednesday night at 7 p.m., right? So I don't just understand, if this doctor who's bringing the doctrine is going to doctor like your doctrine, and he ain't a doctor like you're a doctor, then how can he doctrine the way that you're doctoring things? Because you don't doctrine things. You're just a doctor, right, Doc? So if this is a Dr. Clancy, and Dr. Clancy's coming here to doctor stuff, how come he ain't doctoring like you do?
Festus, what in heaven names got into you, boy?
Well, I'm plumb sorry, Miss Kitty, but I just came from that university church 6 o'clock every Saturday night prayer group. Oh, anointing was so high on the Holy Spirit, I just couldn't stop crowing.
Festus, keep it under control.
And doors were barred, and the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Then just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said, they've moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. Oh, the stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. So we both ran to the garden, and John went on ahead. And we found the stone, an empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how were they taking him? It was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, but what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high.
because I'd seen them crucify him, and then I watched him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. So even if he was alive, he could never be the same. Then suddenly, the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Then Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and I just clung to him and cried. But then he raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Oh, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. Sweet peace. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I'm broken. Heaven's gates open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I'm broken. Heaven's gates open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I'm broken. Heaven's gates open wide. He's alive. Hallelujah. He's alive. Oh, he's
don't you just love Kevin? Yeah. Woo. I feel like some of you came alive in the middle of that. Hallelujah. We have a special guest here today. We're glad for Barnes family's all being here. But Elizabeth O'Brien. Elizabeth, come on up. She's a Chi Alpha representative in Arkansas. We know in Arkansas they need a lot of Jesus. And she wanted to take time to thank you for some of the support you've given.
Hi, my name is Elizabeth O'Brien. I am an MA with Chi Alpha Campus Ministries at the University of Central Arkansas. It's in Conway, which is right a little this way from Little Rock. When I was a Southwestern student, I used to make fun of the Arkansas students because I thought that there was like 20 maybe, but they were very loud people. And so I was always like, they think they're something, but they're not. And then when I graduated in 2015, I somehow immediately moved up to Arkansas, and I've been there ever since. And I don't really see myself leaving, but I wanted to thank you guys and just share a little testimony of what your giving is doing, because I know sometimes we give and we don't know where it goes. But I would say even spiritually, there were seeds that were planted when I was a Southwestern student, that the fruit of it is being seen somewhere else completely that I know people don't know about as well. My grandfather was Dr. James Barnes, and when I moved to Waxahachie, I got to learn about the word legacy, or really I would say the word discipleship. I remember my first day as a freshman, this man came up to me, and his name was Terry Phipps. And he walked me through the freshman like welcome line, and he helped me. I remember he helped me pick my meal plan because I didn't know how to pick these things. And he was kind to me because for lots of reasons, one of them being he's an awesome person. But I know it was also because my grandfather had been kind to him. And discipleship passes on through generations. And so I learned that my time at Southwestern, I got to see the impact that one man had made, James Barnes, that then impacted me generations later. And then I moved away to reach out to university students, and I know that the impact passes on because I know that the Spirit of God moves much stronger than any earthly force can. And so I'm grateful for the opportunity to reach out to university students. And just to share, like, super short testimony, I know this summer was hard for all people and all, like, types of ministries, but even on the university campus, we're under more restrictions than we've ever been. And even, I remember distinctly, in June, after the death of George Floyd and all that was ignited from that, watching so many of our student leaders leave, saying that they didn't want to be a part of this anymore, that they didn't want to disciple, that they didn't want to stand with the church, and my heart broke for it. And I had friends tell me, you're not going to see minority students involved. Like, there won't be anyone to reach out to them. And I can tell you, I'm personally discipling more black women than I've ever discipled in my last 6 years in ministry. Their doors have opened to the women's basketball team that has never been opened before. And it started with discipling the grad assistant, who's now the assistant coach, who opened the door for, we have a Bible study. My first one, I texted two girls and was like, you invite your friends. Like, I won't tell anyone else, you tell them. And I had 9 girls that week. And every single week since then, it's grown that there's, I think, 15 girls total. And I've had 12 of them come to this Bible study. And they've said, like, this has changed my life. This is changing this team. We've seen physical healings on campus. We're still baptizing people with masks on. I am grateful to see that even in the midst of persecution, it just means that the kingdom of God moves even stronger through that. And I just want to thank you guys that it is because of your sacrifice and your giving that there are young people, and there's, like, it just matters to me that the kingdom of God has diversity, that there are minorities that are being impacted because of your giving too. So thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Keep her in your prayers and in your support. Well, I've asked Dr. Jerry Roberts to speak today. I've been intending to do this for months and months and months, and finally I felt like it was a good opportunity. I appreciate this couple. I appreciate their contributions to the kingdom of God and to this church. Would you give a big university welcome, Dr. Jerry Roberts?
Amen. It is a great opportunity to get to speak today. I do appreciate the pastor giving, you know, honoring my missionary past by giving me almost 48 hours notice. We've always joked about the fact that one of the things you have to learn to do if you're going to be a missionary overseas is you need to be ready to speak with about 5 to 8 minutes notice. So 48 hours, almost overprepared. So it is great to get to share today, and really for me it's great because this is one of my favorite times of year to share the Word of God. It's something that's really very dear to our hearts and near to us as a family. We made a practice way back in the 90s. We happened upon a book. We were supporting Focus on the Family at that point. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that ministry or not. And Focus on the Family one year put out this book, and my parents donated and gave us this book, and it talked about how to celebrate Advent. And we're going, what is that? What are you even talking about? Celebrate Advent. And James Dobson had written this kind of devotional book and took you through the weeks of Advent and all this kind of stuff. And so our children were very small, so we got a little, Advent has these four candles that you light throughout this Christmas season. And on Christmas Day, you light a central candle, and it takes you through the Christmas story. And so it's been a really, it's been a big, oh, look, an Advent candle. I like it. Anyway, that's a beautiful Advent wreath right there. But this idea of celebrating Advent has been a part of our family's legacy. I guess you talk about legacy. It's been a part of our family's legacy. Now our children are beginning to take part of it with their children as well. And it's a means by which we can remind ourselves of the real reason for this time period, the real purpose behind this. It's interesting that a lot of the more high churches, the churches that may be Lutheran, Episcopalian, some of the churches like that, they make it a practice within their churches. And it was really interesting because we'd been practicing it for about 5 or 6 years before we went to Latvia. And then we get to Latvia, and it's a Lutheran nation in its background. And everywhere we went, there were Advent wreaths. I mean, in stores, they would have Advent wreaths, and they would have the different candles lit throughout the time. And the neatest thing about that was, they were communist background, but this was something that their grandma did, and they didn't even know why they were doing it. They just knew it was time to light the candles. And that became a means for us to have the opportunity to say, do you know what these candles are about? Do you know what these candles are talking about? And they became an entryway for the gospel message. But anyway, I just wanted to kind of give a little bit of background about that, because today I'm going to be preaching a sermon that would be for the first Sunday of Advent. And today is, in fact, the first Sunday of Advent. When our family celebrates Advent, the first candle, the traditional meaning of the first candle is to look at the prophecies of the coming of Christ. Sometimes we tend to look at this story of this Christmas story, and we tend to look at this Christmas story from the perspective of just this moment in time when a man and a woman had a little baby in a stable, and there were some shepherds and angels and wise men. And we look at it as this one single moment in time, which is wonderful and beautiful, and we continuously need to be reminded of that. But we need to remember that this is not something that happened on accident. This is not something that all of a sudden just came together out of nowhere and pop, all of a sudden this thing happened. This idea of a coming of a Savior had been prophesied from literally the beginning of mankind. As a matter of fact, the very first prophecy of the coming of a Messiah would have been found in the very time that mankind had fallen. Mankind had chosen to sin rather than obey God. At that moment in time when God was pronouncing judgment, and he said that you're going to have to work hard in the fields, and you're going to have sweat on you, and women are going to have difficulties in childbirth, and there's going to be thorns and thistles and all this horrible stuff. In the midst of that, God said, and there will be one born of woman who will crush Satan's head, and he will strike his heel. So the prophecies of the coming of Christ have been from the beginning of mankind. And it's very important to be aware of the fact that this was not just some last-minute plan that God came up with. This coming of a Christ, the coming of a Messiah, a coming of a Savior had been prophesied throughout from the very beginning. Today I want to look at one particular prophecy, and it's in Isaiah chapter 9. It's one you've probably heard before because it's one that we often read around the Christmas season. Isaiah chapter 9. I'm going to read first from verse 2, and this is going to be probably the most important part that we're going to look at today. Isaiah 9, verse 2. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And then we skip down to verse 6, because verse 2 kind of tells us this general idea of what happened, and verse 6 tells us what was specifically going to happen. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. The celebration that we're beginning right now, the celebration that we're taking part in starting this week and going for the next month, is the celebration of light coming into the world. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. There really is probably nothing that better illustrates the Christmas story, and truly the Christian story, than darkness and light. When you look throughout scriptures, and it's actually an interesting thing to do if you have a Bible program or one of those things where you can just search a word and look through it, it's astounding to type in the word darkness and see all the times that the word darkness appears in the scripture. And you begin, when you look through all these different, actually, in the search I did this week, there was 143 instances of the word darkness. I had no idea there was that many. It's amazing. But you start looking through all these different verses that contain the word darkness, and you see, darkness is used as a powerful image of the state of mankind apart from their relationship with God. The state of mankind when he is apart from the grace and the glory and the kindness and the mercy of God. That darkness is what we see there. Hopelessness, separation. Matter of fact, some of the writers, when they talked about the final destination of those who don't know Christ, they referenced it as outer darkness, separation from God. And so this idea of light coming into darkness is such a beautiful image of the Christmas story and of the Christian message. And it's interesting. Without even knowing it, people all over the world during this time season are participating in illustrating this message. People all over the world, not just here in the States, but all over the world, are putting lights up. They're putting lights on their houses, putting lights on their trees, putting lights on their dog houses. I've seen some crazy people. They're putting lights everywhere. And in some nations where they don't do a lot of the colored lights and stuff, they light candles. All over Europe and Eastern Europe, the candles are lit everywhere. Continuously, they have candles lit all over the place and such. And so, in reality, the whole world is taking part in lighting up the darkness. Lighting up the darkness. Now, most of us might not be aware of the fact that in reality, the very reason that we celebrate Christmas, when we celebrate it, is based on this idea of darkness and light. The very reason that we celebrate Christmas on December 24th and 25th is not really related to when Jesus was actually born. Because there's a lot of different ideas about when Jesus was specifically born. It happened so many years ago, and it happened in a different culture, using a different calendar, mind you. Matter of fact, there were two different calendars running at the time Jesus was born. There was a Roman calendar that was keeping dates based on who this Caesar was and how many years he had reigned. And then there was the Jewish calendar that had been running from the time of Abraham, I think. And basically, you had these two. So there's a lot of confusion about this. When we lived in Latvia, it was kind of fun because the Lutherans celebrated Christmas around this time, but the Russian Orthodox didn't celebrate until January 6th. So we got an extra week of Christmas thrown in there at the end. It was great, man. Got to leave up our decorations. Terry left them up to mid-February, approximately. But once again, the Russian Orthodox were pretty sure that Jesus was born on January 6th, and there's a group of Jewish believers who believe that Jesus was born on around April 14th or 15th. And then some scholars tell us he was born in September around the Feast of Tabernacles. And so there's a lack of clarity on that. And I'm okay with that. You got to be okay with that because it was a long time ago. The reason that we celebrate Christmas at this time of year is because the whole planet on the northern hemisphere illustrates this message for us. You might have noticed it a little bit. We don't notice it quite as much here in Texas, but you might have noticed that right around this time of year, every day is getting
shorter. Okay? The sun's coming up a little later in the morning. The sun's going down a little earlier in the evening. And, you know, you can, it's not a problem at all for me to be ready for bed by 8 now because, you know, it's already been dark a few hours. Now, that's just a normal process of the day and night changes and stuff. Now, as I said, we lived for 15 years in the nation of Latvia. Some people know where that's at. A lot of people don't. Latvia is literally, if you go up to Alaska and I don't know about you. When I was growing up, my mom would say, if you keep on digging, you're going to come up in China. Your mom ever tell you that? Okay. If you dig a hole in Alaska, you come up in Latvia. Because they're just opposite of each other on the planet there. So Latvia is about 500 miles from the Arctic Circle, 500 to 600 miles from the Arctic Circle. So needless to say, we experience this time change a little more severely than we do here in Texas. Around this time of year, the sun rises around 9:30-ish. Sun sets around 3:30. Matter of fact, the funniest thing about it is, and this is so hard for us in Texas, and it was for me, it just blew my mind it blew my mind every year, because it happens every year. But every year, it would get to be the middle of December, and I'd look out my back window, and the sun would come up about there, and it'd go up to about here, and then it'd say, I'm done, and go back down. And you'd never even see the sun on the other side of the house. It was only out the back window you could see the sun. And the days were so short, and they kept getting shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter, and down to the point that you didn't feel like you even had a day. It was just dark all the time. Yes, it did feel that way. You went to work in the dark. You came home in the dark. You did we've got funny stories about our kids who occasionally would, you know, they would forget the time change and stuff, and we'd come home early from the Bible school, and they would go upstairs or go and put on their pajamas and say, you know, I think I'm going to bed. And I'd say, Tim, we hadn't had supper yet. Because it's been dark since 3, man. It feels like we're time for bed, and it's only 6. Anyway, now here's the thing, though. These days keep getting darker and darker and darker all the way up until December 22nd and 23rd. And it's when it stops getting darker. And starting right around the 24th and 25th, the days get longer again. That's called the winter solstice. And right around the 24th and 25th is the very first time in Latvia that you go, wait a second, we had an extra 36 seconds of daylight today. I'm exaggerating just a little bit, but from that point on, light comes back to the world. Light is returning to the world. And so when early Christians chose a time to celebrate the coming of Jesus into the world, they chose that time period because the whole planet seems to be illustrating the message that God is saying. On the people walking in darkness, they've seen a great light. On the people walking in the valley of the shadow of death, light has dawned. And so the whole reason that we even celebrate Christmas in the time that we celebrate it is based on this idea of darkness and light. Isaiah chapter 9:2 is one of the first passages of Scripture that we read when we light our first Advent candle. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. I'm not doing a promo for Advent, but I am doing a promo for Advent. Just throw that in here. This is the commercial on the side of the sermon. If you've never done it before, find a way to do it. It is such a powerful thing for you and your families. It's such, because you find one of these books, or you just go, now, man, forget about it. Online, there's hundreds of different ways they tell you what scripture to read in the day, what songs to sing, and all this kind of stuff. But the most interesting thing about Advent for me, once again, illustrating this idea of darkness and light, is on the first week you light one candle. And on the second week you light two. On the third week you light three. On the fourth week. And like we did our first last night, they lit one candle. With my older eyes, I had to use a flashlight to read the scriptures. One candle's not going to do it for me, okay? Just not going to happen. But by the time you get to two candles and three candles and four candles, the room is getting brighter and brighter and brighter. And by the time you reach the day that you light the Christmas candle and there's five candles burning, you can read perfectly. Because light is returning to the world.
light is returning to the world. Light and darkness. So how did this actually come about? The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. This is a prophecy. The primary prophecy, of course, was the people of Israel. That was the target, the first target message. Now, as we know, many of these prophecies that were given in the Old Testament, they have a specific and a generalized application. They have the specific application of the people of Israel this way, and then also the application to the whole world in this way. But the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. At the time of Christ's coming, the people of Israel were walking in darkness. They were walking in darkness in several different ways. Governmentally, as it comes to how the things were going for government, they were not in good days. At the time of Christ's birth, they were living under the Roman Empire. They were, now, and understand, they had been living under oppressive governmental systems, outsiders ruling over them, for around 500 years. Because you had the Assyrians destroyed Israel. The Babylonians destroyed Judah. And then there's another nation, the Medo-Persians destroyed them. And the Greeks destroyed the Medo-Persians. And then the Romans destroyed the Greeks. And each one took their turn ruling Israel. Some of them deported the Israelites. Some of them made them slaves and servants. Some of them stripped away elements of their culture, limited their ability to worship, limited their ability to serve the Almighty God. And they were in this day, they were living on the most powerful governmental system that had existed in the history of mankind up until that day. They were oppressed, and they had absolutely no hope of getting free. They were walking in fear and uncertainty, not even sure whether their nation was going to survive. And that's the darkness they were walking in governmentally. Religiously, they were also walking in darkness. Because even though they worshiped the one true Almighty God, the systems that had been set up for them to worship separated them from God. Their access to God was limited because all they could do is bring the sacrificial animals and bring them to a priest, and that priest would then make the sacrifice for them, and then they would hope that that would provide forgiveness of sins or a coverage or blessing or whatever else. And on top of this distance from God that they had because they couldn't get to Him without these sacrifices, beyond this, we also had the issue of the hundreds, maybe thousands, of the little tiny rules that the religious leaders had added to the Old Testament. I mean, if you read the laws of the Old Testament, those are hard enough to keep by themselves, man. You read through some of the book of Leviticus, and you read through Numbers, you read through all these laws, and they had things about all what kind of fabric you could wear. I think we're all in sin for the fabrics we're wearing today. These are ungodly fabrics. They also itch. But the religious leaders had added all these rules about how far you could walk on the Sabbath and whether or not you could light a fire and whether or not you could feed your animals and whether or not you could do this and that and that and that and that and that. And life was almost unbearable. There was no way to obtain salvation because nobody could possibly follow all of those laws. So even though they were worshiping the one true Almighty God, they were in fact walking in darkness. They lived in darkness. They walked in sorrow and pain and fear and hopelessness. They were slaves to a powerful empire and servants of a heavy religion, awaiting the promise of Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 2. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And then the light came. Turn to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, and then verse 9. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And it's interesting. There are multiple versions of the Christmas story in the Gospels. And John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4 is one of them. It just happens to be the Christmas story from the eternal perspective. It doesn't mention the shepherds and the angels, but it mentions what was really going on from an eternal perspective. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and listen, that life was the light of men. That life was the light of men. And then going down to verse 9, the true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. Isaiah had promised that there would come a day when light would shine in darkness. And then John declares the true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. The light of the world came. He lit up the darkness. He gave hope to the hopeless. He gave mercy to those who were walking in sin. He brought the very kingdom of God to the earth. He restored hope of a relationship with God and restored hope of people living in freedom. So how did people respond to this light when it came? And really there were two responses. Reading same passage, John chapter 1, picking up in verse 4, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. And then skipping over to verse 9 again, the true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came into that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. And you can see really clearly from the very beginning, there were two responses to the light when it came into the world. There were people who received him joyfully. They were the ones who became the followers of Christ, those who jumped in there and believed in him completely, gave their lives to Jesus. They became his disciples, and later on they became his apostles, those that he sent out. And they are the ones who went and proclaimed the message of Jesus to the world. They are the reason that we are meeting today, the reason that we are celebrating Christmas today, is those who did see the light for what it was and receive that light and let that light change their lives. So many did receive him gladly. And yet there were many who refused to receive the light. The scripture says they didn't recognize him. They chose to continue walking in darkness. They chose to continue walking in their darkness. And this reality remains today. It's really interesting that as much as things change, things still stay the same. People today are still walking in darkness. Now, we have our own different types of darkness that are available to us to walk in. We walk in the darkness of being slaves to sin. People without Jesus walk in darkness as being slaves to sin. They feel hopeless. They feel helpless to get out. They feel like there's just no way they're ever going to be any difference in their lives. No way there's ever going to be a different way of life that they're going to live. That's what it feels like to walk in darkness. But the light of the world has come. Sin separates men from God and makes them hopeless and helpless to find freedom. But God is telling you today, the light has come. The light has come. Jesus continued to mention this throughout his teaching. In John chapter 8 and verse 12, John chapter 8 and verse 12, Jesus said this. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but he will have the light of life. Whoever follows me doesn't have to walk in darkness anymore. Moving ahead to John chapter 12. John chapter 12, verse 44 through 46. John 12, 44 through 46. Then Jesus cried out, When a man believes in me, he does not believe in me only, but also in the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. How much more clear can it be? We don't have to live in darkness anymore. Light has come. Apostle Paul, when he was writing to the Colossians, one more statement. I just love this one because it's just right there in the middle of his greeting to the Colossian church in chapter 1, verse 13. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. When he is describing what God has done for the people, while he's describing all of the greatness of the salvation that God has given, he adds this in very clearly. For he has rescued us, Colossians 1:13. He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. Light has come into the world. Jesus has come into the world. And the question is, why would someone choose to ignore the light? Why would they choose to refuse to accept this offer of freedom? Freedom from darkness and fear, from hopelessness. And it's just so amazing to me because I would ask these questions in my mind. Why would somebody refuse this offer when the promise was the people walking in darkness are going to see light, and then light has come, and he is the light of the world. And people who, if anybody will come to me, they don't have to walk in darkness any longer, but can walk in light. Why would somebody not accept that message? And it's like Jesus was answering the question back in John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verses 19 through 21. John chapter 3, verses 19 through 21. And this is pretty intense. This is the verdict. That's pretty definite. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light, for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by truth comes into the light, so it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. There's something about darkness, something about this darkness that people live in that holds on to them. There's something about the darkness of sin that forms a form of bondage. And not only does it create a feeling of fear and anxiety, it creates this feeling of hopelessness as though I could never be anything other than what I am. That's what darkness does to people's minds. It makes them believe they could never be anything except exactly what they are. But Jesus has said it over and over again. He said it in his word. If you come to me, the light of the world, you don't have to walk in darkness any longer. Colossians said it. He delivers us from the kingdom of darkness. This is not just a passive thing that we just kind of have to wander over and hope we're kind of in the light. He delivers us. That is a physical, actual grabbing and pulling out of the darkness and brings you into the kingdom of light. That is the message of Christmas. That is the message that Jesus came to proclaim. The message of light coming into darkness. The light has come. The light has come. And my invitation to you today is this. Don't be satisfied with just going through the motions of illustrating the light. Don't be satisfied with just putting up some pretty lights on your tree or putting up some lights in your apartment window. Don't be satisfied with just kind of going through the motions. The best possible way to celebrate Christmas is by receiving the message of Christ. To be coming fully into the kingdom of light. To surrender the hold that darkness has on you, to give it up and turn and surrender to the light of Christ. And that may be for you, that may be the very specific thing. Right now you're living in that darkness. Right now sin is your oppressive government. Sin is ruling over you. Jesus came to bring you freedom from that sin. And even if you are walking and trying to walk for Christ, today he invites you to come more and more into that relationship with him, more and more into that light. That light, boy, it's difficult because the light shows what we really are, and we don't really like to look at what we really are. That's the big deal, man. That's what Jesus said. That's what keeps us from coming into the light. But here's the deal. The very light that exposes who we are is also the light that saves. The very light that exposes everything about us is the light that heals and restores us. So the invitation is a challenging invitation. But come into the light. Jesus is the light of the world. He forgives sins. He restores lives. He heals that which has been destroyed in the past. He renews that which has been torn down. He is the healer of your soul, of your body, of your mind. He is the healer. He is the light of this world. And the invitation of Christmas is, let the light of Christ come into your life. Let's bow our heads for a moment and pray. Thank you for your light, Lord. We so desperately need it. We so desperately need it in these dark days, in these difficult days. We need your light to bring joy. We need your light to bring peace. And Lord, we need your light to free us from our sinfulness. Lord Jesus, I pray for those who are here right now who need to make a true and powerful decision for you, that today would be that day and today would be that moment that light would come into their lives. As you keep your heads bowed, I want to ask you right now, first of all, if there's anyone here that you today know that you need to be set free from this dominion of darkness, today you need to come in to the light that is Christ. You need to be brought out. You need Jesus to deliver you from that darkness. If that's you, just raise your hand right where you're at. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Anyone else? Let's pray right now. Lord Jesus, thank you for this one. Thank you, Lord, for the awareness that you've, the Holy Spirit, you've pierced through the darkness. You have pierced through the darkness and you've brought light into his heart and mind. I pray right now, Lord, as he confesses his sins, as he pours out his heart to you, as he's opened, Lord Jesus, to receive you today. Today, Lord Jesus, bring your light into his life, we pray. Bring your light into his life, I pray. And there are others right now, Lord. Jesus, bring your light into our lives. For those who are walking in sorrow because of loss, Lord, bring healing and restoration right now. Right now, let it happen now. We're not waiting. We're not praying for something to happen on Tuesday. We're praying right now, Lord, let that peace, that light of Christ to come into that dark place, that depression, that sorrow, right now, Lord Jesus. Right now, lift them up. Bring light into the darkness, we pray. Bring light into the darkness, Lord, that dark spot over in the corner of their heart, the dark sorrow in the corner of their mind. Bring light right now. You are the light of the world. Joy, peace, the very presence of God. Bring it to bear in their lives right now, we pray. We receive you, Lord. We receive your light right now, Lord Jesus. We receive that light right now, Lord Jesus. Let your light shine in our lives, we pray. Let your light shine in our lives, we pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Pastor, you want to come? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jerry. We're living in almost the ultimate darkness today. We don't know what's going to happen governmentally. We don't know what's going to happen financially. We need Jesus. And the songwriter said, I don't know about tomorrow, but I know who holds tomorrow. And I'm going to hold his hand and walk with him. Thank you, Jerry, for reminding us that we live in a season of great light. Would you stand with me? This church is not here so that you get a blessing every time you come in. We're not here so that we can continue to keep something alive 76 years now. We're here to change a world. It's on the wall there. We want to encounter God. We want everyone to encounter God. We want a fulfilled destiny in their lives. And we want to change culture. And part of that is there are hundreds of names in this box that need Jesus. And we are crying out to God every week for God to save these souls. I can tell you there's already been quite a few that have given their life to the Lord. But this morning we're going to pray over this box. Would you extend your hand this way? And would you join me in prayer? Father, in the name of Jesus, we call unto you. And we ask you to give us these souls. You love them, you cherish them, you died for them. And you love them more than any of us could ever love. What love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. And I pray, God, that these men and women that are in this box will come to you. I pray that you put influences in their lives, roadblocks. Stop them, Lord, from their journey to eternal damnation. Make them understand that in the midst of their darkness, there is light. And that light is Jesus. So we claim their souls by the blood of Jesus Christ. We claim their souls because you promised us our households and our friends. We claim these souls because you're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So in Jesus' name, we thank you. We thank you. And we praise you for it. In the name of Jesus. Amen. And amen. And amen. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you for being here today. We have a number of guests, and you have encouraged us and blessed us being with us today. It's good to have you, and we pray that if you're traveling, God will give you traveling mercies. Keep his hand upon you. We're so glad to have Dr. Gwines here today. We're so glad to have Becky and David Smith here today. Now, Becky's supposed to start chemo, I think, tomorrow. And let's pray that everything goes well. We know that God is our healer. Maybe by the time she gets there, the healing's already taken place. Continue to pray for them. Continue to pray for David, that God will give complete healing in his body. All right, raise your right hand. May the Lord bless you and keep you and strengthen you and cause his face to shine upon you. May his glory rest around you like a light that everybody sees and are drawn to Jesus in you. May God bless and prosper you physically, spiritually, emotionally, financially, relationally. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, be blessed today. Amen and amen.